Let's get another perspective on that growing rift between President Marcos and the Dutertes. Joining us now, UP political science professor Jean Franco. Professor, good afternoon to you. Thanks for joining us today and welcome to the program. Nice to see you again.
Yeah. Hello, good afternoon, Carmina. Good afternoon to the viewers.
Right. A lot has happened in the past few days, and we're just in, what, January? We've got a whole year to go. How significant, the verbal attacks that happened over the weekend, that came from the Duterte, the threats as well, and the clapback coming from President Marcos, how significant is that? What is your reading?
Well, I think it's very significant in the sense that on the part of the Dutertes, they still want to show that they have the clout, that can be a real threat to the Marcos administration. It's just unfortunate that the Marcos camp failed to, underestimated the capacity of President Duterte's rhetoric to grab the headlines. And so what happened was that yesterday, Monday, after the two rallies, the tirade of the Dutertes were the headline.
Mm-hmm. But let's talk about motivation here, because you're trying to understand, really wrap our brains around what's happening. Because the Dutertes talked about a lot of things, right? Mm-hmm. In the middle of all those verbal attacks and threats mm-hmm. against the president, they talked about the ICC. They talked mm-hmm. about charter change. Mm-hmm. They talked about a resignation of the mm-hmm. president. But what is their motivation for doing that?
Well, I guess the real motivation is that I think it's the perception that the Marcoses no longer value what they've done. No? I think Baste Duterte captured it in one sentence when he said that his father allowed the burial of Marcos Jr.'s father once he assumed power in 2016. So I guess that's something that they value a lot, and they're probably trying to make sense of why this was not appreciated, or this was not thought of by the Marcoses, no? Now that they're already in power.
But to what end? Just so they can get their appreciation back? What's the end game here for the Dutertes?
Yeah. People on the ground are saying, oh, this is just politics. But then, it's okay to be political for as long as it is for the good of everyone, for the public interest, no? It's normal to disagree on certain matters pertaining to what path this country should take. But if it's for personal interests, that's what's troubling, no? And scary.
Mm. You mentioned a while ago that you see this as a real threat, that they, in a nutshell, it's really a show of force. That's what they intend to do. But then you go to the facts, like for the charter change statements, for example, the former president standing by the Constitution, saying it shouldn't be touched, that what the current administration doing is, piercing, in so many words, piercing through the soul of our nation. But you've got, on the other hand, the facts. That this same president, this same former president, was the one that formed the Constitutional Commission, right? Yes. To look into the possibility of changing the charter.
Yeah.
How does that make sense?
In fact, it was Duterte's campaign promise, I think, no? If I remember correctly. And he actually formed a commission, and I think there was even a book that was promoted, no? On federalism. Well, it just goes to show how empty the bid to change the charter during the Duterte administration was. And also, I think they're doing this right now mainly because they want to ride on the anti-People's Initiative discourse, mainly because the Senate very much disagrees with it, and so they have to toe this line so that they have more clout and more allies.
So as empty as the move to change the charter then during his term, we're talking about the former president here, do you think that there's support now for the anti-People's Initiative is just as empty?
Yeah, of course.
Why do you say so?
Well, because it's obvious that they're just riding into the issue, and they were also probably taken aback by the secrecy, the lack of transparency behind the campaign. And in their bailiwicks in Mindanao, they must have seen these, or they must have heard that there's this campaign going around. So I guess they also wanted to let the initiators of this PI initiative to know that this is not going to happen in our turf.
Meanwhile, let's talk about the motivation of those who continue to support this People's Initiative despite what the COMELEC has decided upon, indefinitely suspending any process that's that will be involved in the People's Initiative. You've got the manifesto coming from the Senate. And despite all that, you still have the support for the project, for this People's Initiative. What's the motivation behind that, Professor?
You know, if you've observed in the previous 3 years, the campaign to change the charter has always been there. But one thing that has not been missed is the bid to change the economic provisions. I'd like to believe that there are private sector interests that would really benefit, from changing the economic provisions of the constitution. That's why there's a very strong lobby for this. Mm-mm. I think, if you lobby for this, there's also the added gift to politicians that there's also a possibility that they can change the charter. That would also be of interest to those who would like to change the terrain of the game, so to speak.
Mm-hmm. But if you're an outsider looking in and seeing how messy things have become in this initial stage, would you still want to invest and put your money here?
Yes. Exactly. This is the very reason why economists who say that it's not, the charter change is not the solution should be listened to, because it's not, I mean, the way it was promoted, like the TV ads that I saw, mm-hmm. it's as if changing the charter is the panacea for all the problems of the Philippines, when experts on development are saying that it's not. It's the corruption, it's the lack of adequate infrastructure that are to be fixed if we want businesses to thrive in the country.
Let's go back to the rift between the Dutertes and the Marcoses. You said that it's a real threat. That's mm-hmm. one thing, but it's another thing altogether to make those threats real, to make true all mm-hmm. those threats. Do you think they still wield enough power to do that?
I think they still wield enough power, given that Sara Duterte is still the vice president. But, the rhetoric of Duterte is very effective to his political base. So, and it really grabs media attention. And that's something that you do not need if the country has a lot of problems mm-hmm. to be addressed.
All right, so let me just go back again to the motivation there, because you talked about the motivation of those who support the People's Initiative, those who are against it. But what could be the motivation of the president, who's in the middle of all this, to sort of not lift a finger, to not say it himself, whatever his position is? What could be the motivation of the president to keep silent? Go ahead.
Yeah. I mean, like what the previous analyst said, he was looking at the personality of the president. He may be risk averse. And I think the best way for him to do is, you know, rein in the initiators of this charter change and all these quarreling factions, because he has to dispel the growing perception that he is a weak leader. Marcos could not afford to be perceived as a weak leader. We have many challenges domestically and regionally, and that's something that he should have in mind, especially when he is regarded as a weak leader. Mm. I mean, perceptions matter in politics, no?
And if this goes ahead without anything coming from the president, who stands to hurt the most? Who stands to benefit the most from the current scenario?
You know, it's the Filipino people who stands to lose, no? Because we're just recovering from the pandemic, and you know, we need to work. Our leaders need to work very hard, no? To be able to overcome our challenges. But people who will gain from this are those who are also planning to run, no? In the 2025 and 2028 elections, because they can see the political space, no? As to, I mean, because of what happened last Sunday and the continuing rhetoric from both sides. Mm-hmm.
And finally, Professor, you know, you've got both sides. We talked about it already. You talked about the Filipino people as well. There's one sector that we haven't talked about. Where is the opposition in all of this?
Yeah.
Are you looking for them too?
Exactly. Yeah. Yeah. I think they should seize the moment in whatever way they can. They should recalibrate their forces, their strategies, and seize the moment in what's happening right now. They cannot continue with what they've been doing before, because we've seen two elections, 2019 and 2022 elections, where the opposition has practically been decimated. So they need to recalibrate, regroup, and look for better and new strategies.
Professor Jean Franco there of the UP Department of Political Science, thank you so much for joining us this noon. Really appreciate your insights. Take care.
Many thanks.